This morning, I'm starting a series. I'm giving you the introduction of a series that I go into the body of the series next month, which is next Sunday. I'm talking to you today about power of vision. Someone say power of vision. Let's try that again. Power of vision. The power of vision. Come on, say the power of vision. Now, in the things of God, in life, your sight is very, very important. What you see, how you see, the way you see makes a big difference concerning your entire life. You are where you are today because of what you see. We are where we are as a church today because of what we see. There is power in your sight. If I can help you see yourself to be big, you suddenly begin to think big, you begin to talk big, you begin to act big, you begin to respond big. If I can see yourself to be small, you begin to talk small, you begin to think small, you begin to respond small, you begin to act small. See, that is why we tell people to dress appropriately. You don't have to wear suit and tie all the time, no. But at least dress appropriately because you are either, based on your sight, you are either a suspect or a prospect. Somebody can walk to you and look at you and they don't know anything about you, but based on what they see, they will evaluate you and make a judgment call, right or wrong, just based on what they see. People always judge the book by its cover, even though they shouldn't, but we all do. So the power of vision, what do you see? What do you see? If you open your Bible to the book of Exodus chapter 7, Exodus chapter 7, verse 2. Actually, I'll read from verse 1. The Bible says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, see." God needed Moses to see who Moses was, or the way God sees him, in order for Moses to enter into his destiny. The first thing life will do to you is to tell you are not what God said you are. If I want to bring you down, all I need to do is to paint a wrong picture of yourself to you. And if I can get you to buy into that picture, I don't have to say anything. You will do my bidding for me by yourself. How many times have you gone to the street or you watch on TV some of the most beautiful girl, women, selling their body on the street? I say, how can she do that? She's beautiful. Everybody is trying to lose weight. She's already lost weight. Everybody's trying to look like her. And yet, she will sell herself for nothing. Why? And yet, you see somebody that nobody even considers good looking, but she's bold. She's confident, she knows who she is, and she gets everything she wants. It's your mindset. The way you see yourself goes a long way to determine the way you respond in life. So it's important for your vision to be corrected, to be fixed. It is not so much the color of your skin, where you are born, who you hang out with. It is the way you see yourself that determines who you hang out with. So look at this scripture. The Bible says, God told Moses, see, I have made you a God to Pharaoh. But it doesn't make any difference what I've made you if you don't see it. You know, it doesn't make any difference what God has called you, what God has put inside of you, the gift, the talent, the opportunity, the wisdom you have, if you can't see it, it makes no difference. That is why you see kings walking barefooted and slaves riding on horses. Because the Bible says, as a man see, as a man think, so is he. Your sight needs to be fixed. Your sight needs to be corrected. Your sight needs to be adjusted in order for you to enter your destiny. In order for you to change the world, to make a difference in the world, you have to see properly. Many of us need spiritual sight adjustment. We suffer from spiritual cataract. Many of us are spiritually short-sighted. We cannot see beyond our nose. So we make quick, cheap decisions that messed up our future. The power of vision. So God says, I've made you God. I've made you God to the most powerful king in the world. But you have to see it first. Because until Moses saw who God called him, he was running from Pharaoh, who was supposed to run from him. Moses ran from Pharaoh. Yet, Pharaoh was supposed to be his sandwich. He's supposed to eat Pharaoh for dinner. Yet, he was running from Pharaoh. And it took 40 years for God to correct Moses' vision. It took God performing all kinds of miracles, telling him to drop his rod, turning to snake, showing him bush that was burning without being consumed. God kept on telling Moses, 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 I'm sending you to Pharaoh. Moses, Moses said, no, I can't go. God said, go. How many times has God told you something and you said no? How many times do you have something in your mind that you want to do, something you think you should do, and you talk yourself out of it? Has that ever happened to anybody? Let me ask a question. If you have opportunity, if you can live your life all over again, how many of you think you can do better than what you are doing right now? Or how many of you think your life is perfect? You did it all right. Because your action is based on your vision. Remember this. That's why the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. Because your action is based on your vision. You respond the way you respond. You talk the way you talk. You spend the way you spend. You give the way you give. You go to place where you go to because of the way you see yourself. It is not the government that is influencing you. It's the way you see yourself. It's your internal side. It's your vision of yourself. So God began to show us scripture after scripture to define our side. He says, you are the head and not the tail. You should lend to nation and not borrow. You are strong and not weak. He says, let the weak say, I am strong. He says, even if you don't feel strength, don't ever say you are weak. Say you are strong. God wants you to see what he wants you to see. God wants you to see what he has put in you. God wants to see the way he sees you. Because if you can see it, you can walk yourself back to where God has created you and put you. So God told Moses, look, look, see. See who I've made you. I know you are scared now, but see. I know you are frustrated now, but see, but I know you are afraid, you are stressed out, but see, Moses, just see. See, I want you to see. You need to look beyond what is around you. You need to look beyond what you feel. You need to look beyond what people say. I want you to see the way I see you. I know today you are a shepherd of ordinary sheep, but I have a call upon your life to be the greatest pastor in the Old Testament. So you need to see this. I know the children of Israel have been in bondage for over 400 years, but you are the one that I'm going to send to deliver them. But you have to see that first. I know Pharaoh is trying to kill you, but no man can kill who I have not killed. So you have to see that I've made you God. I know you are a Jew and you are Egyptian. You are a Jew, Egyptian Jew. You don't even know who you are, but just see yourself like I see you. It doesn't matter your foundation. It doesn't matter your beginning. It doesn't matter what they call you. I know the Jew don't like you because they think you are stuck up because you grew up in Pharaoh's palace. And I know Pharaoh, the Egyptian, wants to kill you because they know you are. You are so confused. But just see yourself the way I see you. Because if you see yourself the way I see you, it doesn't matter what people call you, you will answer to what I have called you. See! Somebody shall see! See. So you have to see. Because if you see, you cannot be stopped. If you see, you cannot be slowed down. If you see, you cannot be distracted. If you see, you cannot be confused. If you see, you cannot be pushed aside. If you see, nobody can turn you down. If you see, you will go through the wall. You will go through the metal. You will get to anywhere. You just have to see. Somebody shout, see. It doesn't matter if you don't have money, if you can see it, oh, you can get it. It doesn't matter if you are broke, if you can see what God has called you, you can get anything you want. It doesn't matter if we have no money, we can build a $2 million building if we can see it. I know what I'm talking about. Because when we came here, we were broke, busted, and disgusted. There was no money. And people were saying, Pastor, how are you going to do this? And I said, God will provide. How much do you have in the account? You don't want to know. It will discourage you. We are going to go to town center, and we are going to build that building. I'm so glad God didn't show me it's going to cost $2 million. God just said, go. You can do it. See. Few months ago, I preached a sermon here that how doesn't matter. Many of us get stuck with how. How am I going to pay for it? How am I going to do it? How am I going to get there? And you get stuck there, you can't move further. You have to go beyond how and just see. He says, I set before you nations and kingdom. With you, I shall root out and pull out and destroy and build and plant. He called Gideon and said, you mighty man of God. And Gideon says, who are you talking about? God said, you. He said, Gideon said, you have no clue. See, God said, be quiet, just see. Then Gideon said, are you sure you're talking about me? God said, yes. Okay, if I'm just to be sure you're talking about me, let me fleece you, God. Say, let us put a fleece on the ground, and this morning, let us make sure the fleece is filled with water and the ground around it is dry. Maybe I will believe you. So they came the following morning, and the fleece is filled with water and everything around him is dry. Say, wow, that's incredible. Maybe it is God talking to me. Let me be sure. Okay, if it is you, God, make sure the fleece is dry and everything around the fleece is wet. And he came back the following morning and the fleece was dry and everything around the fleece was wet. I say, wow. I say, but I don't feel it, God. God said, just say. I say, but everybody don't think I'm nobody. I'm somebody. God said, don't worry. Just say. Don't worry about what they call you. What is important is what you answer to. So God told Gideon, then he told Moses, he says, see. He says, see, I've made you God over your problem. Pharaoh stands for trouble. Pharaoh stands for impossible situation, difficult circumstance. That's what Pharaoh stands for. Pharaoh stands for the financial struggle you are faced with now. Stand for your health issues. Stand for issues in your family, with your spouse, with your children, whatever it is in your job, your career, whatever you are dealing with now, that is your Pharaoh. God says, if you can see yourself as a God over that Pharaoh will bow before you. Now, Pharaoh will not bow willingly. You will break his knees. But you have to see first. Turn to your neighbor, see. Come on, turn to your neighbor, open your eyes. Tell them, open your eyes. Open your eyes and see. The power of vision. Hebrews chapter 12. The book of Hebrews chapter 12. I read from verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Then look at verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him. Watch this. Who for the joy that was set before him. Who, because of that joy that was set before Jesus Christ, because of what he could see ahead. Nobody else could see the joy. Everybody saw pain and frustration and discouragement and blackmail and killing and destruction and stabbing and crucifixion. But the Bible says because of the joy that was set before, in other words, because of what he could see, not because of what is happening around him. If he goes by what is happening around him today, he will be discouraged, he will be despondent, he will be disappointed, he will be distracted. He has to look beyond his present circumstance. He has to go beyond the report in his hand. He has to go beyond the bill on his table. He has to go beyond what people are saying around him. He has to go beyond people's imagination and comment and thought. He has to go beyond what he feels. He has to go beyond what he thinks. He has to begin to see something that God said before him that is beyond where he is right now into the future. So the Bible said because of the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. He despised the shame so that he can see it on the right hand side of the Father. I'm here to tell you this morning, there is somebody here that has to look beyond where they are right now. There is somebody here that has to look beyond what they feel right now. There's somebody here that has to look beyond what they think right now. There's somebody here that has to look beyond the report on their table right now, because there is a joy that is set before you, and you have to focus on that joy so that you can endure the pain and despise the shame, so that you can go beyond your present circumstances into your future. Somebody shall see. See. He says, because of the joy that was set before him. Let me ask you a question. What joy has God set before you? What vision have you seen? What expectation have you dreamt of? What is your dream? What do you see? I'm not talking about what you see right now. Don't be carried away by the present circumstances. Those things that are visible, they are temporal. The ones that are invisible, they are eternal. So open your spiritual eyes. You might have to close your physical eyes for a moment so that you can see what God is saying. If you focus on the pain, you will be blinded to the vision. If you want to become a medical doctor, you have to constantly remind yourself that when you become a medical doctor, you're going to make good money. And you're going to be able to help so many people. And you're going to have that DR in front of your name. You have to keep looking that you're going to be the pride of your family. You will have fulfilled a long, lifelong dream. You have to keep looking at that vision of being Dr. So-and-so. Because if you don't, all the books you have to read, all the money you have to pay, all the practical and clinical you have to do, all your friends are graduating in 2-3 years, 12 years later, you are still a student? Are you listening to me? If you take your eyes off the big picture, the small picture will destroy your dream. I have to constantly look at the big picture of this church, because if I don't, you guys are crazy. I have to look beyond the jiving, the talking, the trashing, and the whining, and the complaining. I have to look sometimes beyond the offering. Hello? I have to put the picture in front of me of what God has said to me. I have to go beyond Pharaoh. I have to go beyond the discomfort. I have to look what God has said to me. I have to look beyond the Sunday that the chairs are full and the Sunday that the chairs are not so full. I have to look beyond day-to-day workings and I have to look at the big picture, what God has said. Because I have to do that so that I can endure the pain and despise the shame. When you take your eyes off the big picture, the pain becomes unbearable. The shame becomes unsustainable. Why do you think Jesus Christ, the Son of God, God in flesh, the Almighty God in human form, will come to the world and allow the man that he created to beat him up? Think about it. He left the heavens of heavens that is paved with gold. Angels bow before him. He was the shining star, the bright morning star. He was the Son of the living God. He created everything. Bible says with him, all things were made, right? That was made. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. Without him, there was nothing made that was made. In him was life. This life was the light of man. And this light shines in darkness. And darkness comprehended, and the Word became flesh. He was the one that created everything. How dare you slap Jesus? How dare you spit on Jesus? How dare you kick Jesus? How dare you call Jesus names? Can you imagine how shameful, how embarrassing that is? It's like me walking to this church butt naked. I'm the pastor. I won't come back. It's too embarrassing. Can you imagine what a disgust for man to slap Jesus, to call him name, to say crucify him? Why would Jesus take all those pain? Why would Jesus permit such disrespect? Why would Jesus have to cry to God, Father, Father, why have you forsaken me? Because he has to look beyond what he was going through at that point. The reason why many people made dumb decisions is because they look away from the big picture. They focus on the present pain and they make decisions to alleviate today at the expense of tomorrow. How many times have you quit school because it was uncomfortable? Now, those of you that finished school and you got your PhD, your master's, whatever incredible degree you got, how many times, seriously, how many times did you think of quitting? Can I see your hand? Sometimes you are about to take your final, the last exam tomorrow and you want to quit today. I'm like, what are you doing? Something's wrong with your head. You have to slap yourself back to shape. Because are you kidding me? I've been doing this for 6 years. I have my finals tomorrow. I study now. I quit today. Because if you don't understand the big picture mindset, if you don't keep the vision in front of you, the pain becomes too great. The discomfort, the stress, the pressure become too great. God said this is a year of growth and glorious change. And when you go into growth, you go through pain. When you go through changes, it's never comfortable. I'm here to tell you this morning, ask you a question. What has God told you about yourself in your secret time with God, in your prayers, as you drive your car, in your shower, when you are praying, when you are worshiping God, when you are doing grocery shopping, and God just dropped an answer into your spirit, and you look around, where did that come from? Oh my God, that was God talking to me. And many times God will tell you things that don't make sense. It's so way off where you are. Many times what God tells you, your environment does not support it. So as we go into this series, I'm going to explore the power of vision. Don't miss it. If you miss it, you will cry. Because you need vision for your family. You need vision for your finances. The reason why many of us struggle financially is because we have no vision. We just, the money come, the money go, or what happened to your money? I don't know. I spend it. I can't wait for the next paycheck. You need vision for your health. You need vision for your ministry. You need vision for your relationship. There are some people you need to hang out with. There are some people you need to run away from. There are folks you need to delete from your Facebook page. You should not be associated with them. You need vision. There are people you don't listen to. There are people you need to listen to. You need vision. There are places you shouldn't go. There are places you shouldn't miss. You need vision. Because your vision will map out your life for you. Your vision is the picture of your desired end. Your vision will determine how you spend your time, how you spend your money. Do you know that many times they try to make Jesus king on earth? Do you know that in the Bible? They try to kidnap him and crown him king. I mean, he was raising the dead, he was healing the sick, he was casting out devils, especially feeding people for free. 5,000 men. Free food? Jesus, can you do this every day if you become the mayor? They wanted to make him king. And the Bible says Jesus Christ snuck away and escaped because of his vision. Do you know that the enemy of the best is the good? The enemy of the best is not bad, it's good. There are many of us that have settled for good at the expense of the best. Because if you don't have a vision, you will settle. Many of us have settled because we lack vision. Many of us have settled because we lack vision. Well, this is not bad, but is that the plan of God for your life? Are you supposed to go from paycheck to paycheck? Is that the plan of God for your life? Are you supposed to constantly get calls from American Express, Discover Card, Visa, MasterCard? Is that the plan of God for your life? Every month you have to figure out how to pay your mortgage. Is that the plan of God for your life? Every day you don't know where your children are. You don't know where your husband is. You don't know where your wife is. Is that the plan of God for your life? Today you are sick and tomorrow you are well. And then you are sick and you are well. Oh, praise God, I'm well today, tomorrow. Is that the plan of God for your life? You need a vision. Vision makes sacrifice easy. Maybe painful, but easy. Because you have seen it in your spirit, even if no one else understands it. Vision motivates you to endure, be long-suffering and patient, willing to pay the price others will never consider paying for what you have seen in your heart. Without long-sightedness or vision, there is no future. There is no greatness. We are simply confined and constrained to day-to-day winds of occurrences and happenings around us. There will be no stability or clear path to fulfillment without vision. Vision gives you enough reason to wake up in the morning and keep going. Vision puts fire in your belly, excitement in your heart, and passion in your soul. Vision do not allow you to see obstacles. And when you see it, it doesn't matter. Your vision overrides your obstacles. Vision makes your dream big and your problem small. It allows you to see your problem for what it truly is, a distraction. Someone with vision cannot stay in a continuous state of depression. In fact, for you to be perpetually depressed, the first thing life takes from you is your vision, is your sight. You can't see up anymore. You can't see any reason to keep going. It takes a blind man or blindness for you to commit suicide. You will never see a person with a vision that kill himself. It's not possible, even if there is chemical imbalance. Did you hear what I just said? It takes an extreme case of spiritual blindness, lack of vision, to be suicidal. It is when someone can't see the reason to keep living. When you see someone with vision, he or she could be going through the worst situation in life, the most impossible circumstance. He or she just keep going. That's why Jesus Christ says, the Bible says, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. Because of his vision, he was willing to bear the cross. He didn't bear the cross because it was easy. He bore the cross because of his vision. He has a vision to redeem man. He has a vision to win souls. He has a vision to change the world. So the pain and the frustration was not strong enough to stop him. So the Bible says, because of the vision, the joy that was set before him, he endured. When you see somebody that stopped enduring, the vision is blurred or has been taken away. When you hear somebody say it is impossible, it means the vision is dead. When you hear somebody say it cannot be done, it means they lack vision or they've lost their vision. It takes the death of vision for marriages to dissolve. The two parties will say something like this: due to irreconcilable differences. That means we don't have the same vision anymore. That's what it means. For any venture to die, the vision has to first die. Are you following me? For any venture to come to an end, the vision first has to come to an end. The Bible says, write down the vision. Make it plain. So that whosoever read it can run with it. In order for you to keep running, you need vision. Because if you are not with vision, you are going to get tired. Once you stop seeing it, you start running out of energy. Did you hear what I just said? Once you stop seeing it, have you seen people that are governors, they just resign while they're in office? Have you seen that before? Sarah Palin, an example. He was a governor. She was a governor. She just resigned because she stopped seeing the vision. She stopped seeing, what am I here for? How many times have you seen senators? Right? They spend millions of dollars to win the election. They go from city to city. They work themselves to death. And then they get to the office and find that it was not what they thought. They stop seeing the vision. So they resign. So when we come and God said, this is a year of good and glorious change, you know what God is trying to do? He's trying to set a vision in front of us. How are we going to build this gigantic building? Where are the people going to come from? Where is the money going to come from? If you can't see it, it becomes a wasted effort. Listen to this. I'm going to finish with it because of our time. I'll continue. This is just introduction next week. Vision always finds a way. Vision, if you have the vision, you always find a way. When you have a vision and hold on to your vision and believe in your vision, the universe will always create a way for you. Vision can never, never fail. Vision can never fail. You can beat down a vision, it will come right back up. You can hold down a vision, it will pop up on the other side. Vision is patient, and yet do not become a patient. As we start a new month, God is calling us to renew our vision. What is the vision for your life? Why are you here? What is your goal? What do you see? Vision is sight. What do you see? In this coming month, God will begin to recreate and repaint the picture for our life for us so that we can run with strength. So that we can run with determination and passion. My prayer is that God will renew your vision. I say, God will renew your vision. I say, God will renew your vision. So that you can keep running. Rise up on your feet.